Quincy, we are going on a road trip.
Woo!
Yes, absolutely.
Hello and welcome to the Paul Garcia Show, a show about the remarkable people of Central Illinois. I'm your host, Paul Garcia, and I invite you to join me as I speak with these individuals about their stories, the lessons they've learned, and the knowledge they've gained along the way. Tune in every Sunday to witness the power of bringing each new individual's unique journey into the spotlight. Patrick Barnes, thank you so much for coming on to the show today, man. I appreciate it a lot.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, my pleasure. So you're kind of something of a social media titan, in my humble opinion. And I'm serious. And if you wouldn't mind, could you kind of tell the listeners, roughly, if you know, how many followers do you have across all social media platforms?
Across all social media?
Yeah, like if you know how many you have, like, TikTok,
like just like combined
Instagram.
Or some, probably anywhere between like 4 to 5 million.
4 to 5 million.
Yeah, somewhere in there. I don't know the exact, but yeah.
I think that's more than any, like the biggest cities in the United States, their populations. I'm pretty sure that's more than all of them. Definitely more than Chicago. That's like 2 million.
I had never thought about it like that, but yeah, it's crazy how it all happened, but yeah.
Yeah, so I'm very curious, where did this all start? Did you grow up as a kid playing with video cameras or what? Where did this all begin?
Well, it all began in college during the summer. When I was growing up, it was never like I had a camera always filming like my brothers. No, I went to college and one summer I came home and there was do you remember the app Vine?
Oh yeah. Yeah. 6 second videos.
Yeah, there were 6 second like video clips. And it came out that summer. So I was just at college and came home for the summer. And there was this like challenge, like this hashtag that was going on. It was like hit that high note, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And so my dog, you know, me and my brothers like knew that he could do this like singing howling thing from when he was like a little puppy. And so I was like, oh, I'm just going to hop on this trend, this hashtag. And so I did this song, Celine Dion, like the Titanic song, My Heart Will Go On.
Oh, yeah. Okay. How's that go? Yeah, I mean,
do you want me to
sing it?
I wish I had Quincy here. I could redo
the
video.
Is it the one that's not?
It's
and
like,
I...
near, far, wherever. So I'm an awful singer. So. So, like, the video didn't go viral from me singing. It was It was because he sang, but it was just funny. I was just on the couch. And it was just like, obviously, it was just 6 seconds. So it wasn't like a whole song. It was just this little snippet of me doing it. And Quincy's on my lap, just like singing it with me. And, you know, I probably had 10 followers or something. And I post it. And then I wake up the next day and it had like 3,000 likes. I'm like, what? This doesn't make any sense. How did I only 10 people follow me? How did this happen? And it was, I guess, because people found it on the hashtag. And then I got this small following. I maybe had like 1,000 followers after that. And then I was like, well, I'm just going to keep doing these videos with my dog. And, you know, now what is this, like 6, 7 years later, and I'm still making videos with my dog.
Okay. So you were in college, you came home and you saw your dog. And so what exactly, I know, but I'm sure a few listeners might not know. Okay. What exactly did your dog do? You said it sang.
Yeah.
Explain what exactly Quincy, your dog, does.
So there's a couple different things that the videos that have gone viral that he does. But the first thing was singing. So like, if you hit like certain notes, like I can't sing for my life, but I can just like get to a certain note. And if you get there, he just like starts mimicking you. So a song will come on and you start singing. It's funny. There's a song that he always sings, The Saints Go Marching On. So like, you'll just be like, if I just start going like, rah, 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 like within a couple seconds, like he starts like, and he starts howling and going along with it. So it was just little things like that that we caught on early. And then there's like some of the other stuff that has gone viral is like he gets very like snappy, and when you'll like try to, he'll have like a toy on the ground and you'll go for it and he'll like snap at you. And then I always have some like extravagant reaction, like I'll scream really loud. And then people, I don't seem to like the video. So those are like two of the main things that he's done that And then the other stuff is just some relatable skits. I'll just like, any dog owner can relate to some of the like skits that I'll do. And so it's just a combination of those three things, I guess, are really what built the following.
So when did you first start to receive, you know, notable levels of attention? You had like 1,000 followers mm-hmm. overnight, 3,000 likes on that video. Mm-hmm. When did you just keep that following and then kind of never left and just kept growing?
Right. So it was just like a, how I think of all social media, whether it's your podcast or anyone just starting out on social media, it's like a snowball effect. So the first, probably the first like 25,000 followers that anyone gets is probably the hardest that like the longest amount of time or the hardest that I'm trying to think of what to say. The first like 25 to 50,000 followers or even up to 100,000 followers is always the hardest amount to get. Mm. Everything after that, it's like a snowball effect because your video is like 100,000 people already see you. They can start sharing your videos and it goes to more people. Just things start spreading way easier. So what happened was I just started continuing making the videos and it just kept, it was like a snowball effect. And I would say there's one video that really like took it to the next level and it was on like different TV shows and things like that.
Wow.
Yeah, it was like I was just in my car and I'm like, Quincy, we're going on a road trip. Woohoo! And he like mimics me and he's like, woo! And he's all excited. And it was just a 6-second clip just like that. And it blew up. That one has like over 100 million views now. So.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
100 million views where? On
just across whether you – I mean on Vine alone it had like 70 million. But then like on Facebook it has – I don't know, 30 to 50 million and then YouTube people and then just different news outlets that mm-hmm. have posted it. So yeah, that video went crazy and that's really what I guess like spiked the following even more, but yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to say something that might be, you know, kind of interesting. I don't know if I should say it. I'll say it. It's,
we are brought to you by Tricia's Treasures in Fairbury, Illinois. From gorgeous jewelry and fabulous furniture to one-of-a-kind collectibles and repurposed goods, Tricia's Treasures is truly a treasure chest of unique gems. This charming Fairbury store is host to a vast selection of antiques and vintage goods, furnishings, rare and historic memorabilia, and more that is sure to catch your eye and warm your heart. Tricia's Treasures also specializes in refurbishing and repurposing furniture, containers, machinery, or anything that your creative mind can think to do something with in order to do their little part in reducing our environmental footprint. Simply put, this place is an Etsy and Pinterest paradise that you simply have to come visit. They have thousands of pictures of their inventory on their Facebook page, and they even offer local delivery as well. So for one-of-a-kind antiques, art, collectibles, furniture, gifts, and for any of your refurbishing and repurposing needs, check out Trisha's Treasures in Fairbury, Illinois, located in the old bowling alley on the west end of town, right off of Route 24. Once again, that's Trisha's Treasures, a treasured vintage store. We're going postscript here for just a second. For those of you in the Fairbury area, Trisha's Treasures will have a stand at the Experience Fairbury event this Monday at Wells on Main at 5:30 p.m., along with many other local vendors. So be sure to stop by for some excellent eats, treats, and treasures.
I don't know if I should say it. I'll say it. It's, so you are my brother-in-law.
Yes.
You're
yes.
My sister Ann's husband.
Uh-huh.
And I've always thought it was funny because I went to school at Milliken. In my freshman year, I was on iFunny, the app iFunny. I'm sure you know it.
Yeah, no, I used to talk to the creator of that app. And so like every time I would post a video, I would submit it to him and then he would like feature it on iFunny.
Oh my gosh,
yeah,
really?
Yeah.
You cheated.
I cheated.
No, you had, because guys had to make memes and they had to post funny videos like on their account and pray and hope that it got featured on the feature page.
Yeah.
But you had a connection to where.
It's not like featured. I knew him personally. It was just like a thing. I think he somehow where he reached out to me or something and he's like, I don't know how it came. I honestly don't remember how it came about, but it was just like, he's like, okay, every time you like make a video, just send it to me and if I really like it, I'll feature it. And so I had several videos that I would send to him and they would feature it on iFunny.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, the interesting thing is, in on my side of things is that I remember liking a video, that video of Quincy saying woohoo.
The road trip one?
Yes. And actually a few other videos before I even knew who you were, that you were in the area, let alone that you and my sister started, this is before you guys started dating.
Right, right.
But even when you started dating, I'm like, who is that guy? You know, and kind of knew you were on Vine.
Yeah.
But then I put it together that you're the guy in these videos. It was insane. I was
That's funny.
Yeah, and I want to touch on this. It's that you don't just make, and you didn't just make videos with Quincy.
Mm-mm.
I saw some really funny videos of you doing street magic.
Yeah, that was another thing that actually I completely forgot about. That was, I did like, that's one thing that since I was a kid I've always enjoyed is like magic tricks. So there was this like trick, this cool trick I learned, and it was perfect for 6 seconds. And it was like, I could take this of water and I'd pour it into a cup, mm-hmm. and then I'd act like I threw the water on someone, but the water will have disappeared. Mm-hmm. And so I did that all, and I was at college, so I had a bunch of students to do the prank on. So yeah. I just did that, and it was like a quick, easy, you pour the water in, you do it, someone screams, and like I did a whole series of that, and that also actually, yeah, I completely forgot about that, but.
Didn't you say that one time you were like kind of in the ghetto area of the city?
Yeah.
You were in a gas station? Tell that story.
Yeah, I was doing these magic tricks and one time, well, the magic trick, it did not work. It wasn't so magic. And I pour the water in and I go like this, and well, the water was still in there. It didn't disappear. And it was like this 6'5" dude. And we were like in kind of like the ghetto of Dayton, Ohio, mm-hmm. where I did it. And I mean, his face, he just looked like, because he was kind of like laughing at first and he didn't realize it went all over his shoulder. And I was just like, and my filmer just looked at me and he just walked right out the door. He just took off. And then I just looked at him and I was like, I'll, and I went to the bathroom and I got some paper towels and I like came up to him and I was like, I'll give you $5.
Did he take it?
Yeah, I whipped out the $5. It was like all I had in my wallet. And I just give it to him and he just like stares at me. He didn't say a word and he just snatches the $5 and walks out. And I was like, I thought I could have lost my life that day.
Yeah. Oh,
I was, my heart was pounding in that gas station. And then I think that was the last street magic video I did. I don't think I did another one after that. Like I think I might have done a different trick. Mm-hmm. After that, but that was it for that trick. I never did it again.
That is so funny. It's like, from that guy's perspective, you just walked up to him and made a joke out of him.
Yeah, and that's what he thought. He didn't realize, like, I was trying to explain. I was like, no, listen, this is supposed to work like this. Like, show him, like, a video of how it's supposed to work. But he did not care. He just took that $5 and walked right out.
That is so funny.
Yeah.
And what other kind of content do you create? Because I don't want to, you know, harp on this too long.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not just Quincy that gets you, you know, all your followers. There was a street magic,
mm-hmm.
and then there's also your brother, right?
Yeah, my brother Thomas. He is quite a character for anyone that knows him. He basically wears suits like everywhere he goes. He talks with like a British accent, but he's born in America. He's
Thomas.
Yeah.
How was your experience in Chicago?
Marvelous.
It's 70.
So many oysters and martinis.
Yeah, well, it's 70 degrees, so why are you wearing a scarf?
Aesthetic purposes.
Oh my gosh, Thomas.
He's born in America. He's born in California. And it's just funny. Like someone at my wedding, actually, I think it was one of your uncles or something, like looked over and he said, and it was Thomas giving he was my best man, so he was giving the speech, mm-hmm. and he looks at me and he goes, who's the British guy? And
he could fool anyone.
And it's funny because probably a lot of people thought that, but no, he's just my brother, and he has a lot of different quirks. And so, mm-hmm. yeah, on my YouTube channel, I would say all of my social media besides my YouTube is mainly focused on Quincy, mm-hmm. but my YouTube, I do like vlogs and stuff, and it's still a lot of Quincy, but Thomas is a lot more involved with my YouTube
mm-hmm.
than other social media.
Yeah. And, you know, maybe Thomas will watch this. I'm a huge fan of Thomas. To be honest, like, I love Quincy. I think those videos are great.
Yeah.
I love the videos with Thomas.
Yeah,
Thomas, I've talked to him.
Uh-huh.
How do you explain the type of person he is? You said he's quirky, but he really loves, like, this 19... 20s, 30s, 40s era of gentlemanly, like yes. the gentleman culture.
Yes.
And he loves fine dining.
Fine drinks, fine dining, fine clothes.
His suits are exquisite. Like they are awesome.
They're crazy. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He doesn't own a pair of jeans or a pair of like shorts.
Wow.
He only owns just like dress clothes, and his closet is mm-hmm. full of just ties and bow ties and... Yeah, he dresses like an old man or someone from like the 1940s. It's crazy, but that's just him, and that's why I think more people are like drawn, because that's different. Like people don't see mm-hmm. that every day.
Yes, and he's a nice guy, sense of humor. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting. I've never seen it before, mm-hmm. and it makes the pranks that you pull on him that yeah. much better, because they just so sharply contrast his yeah. personality.
Yeah,
he's not about to play those type of games, those right. childish games.
Exactly. His reactions to, yeah, that's, an, yeah, I pranked my brother quite a bit. Mm-hmm. Maybe not in recent times, but I have plenty of times on my YouTube channel pranked him, and his reactions are always gold. Like most people would just kind of be like, I'm tired of this, like go away, like, and not really give that good of a reaction. But with him, it's every reaction is gold. Every time.
Has he ever gotten mad at you?
Like, oh, yeah.
Really like, mad? Like to where the video stops and he's not laughing or anything?
I'm trying to think. I probably can't think of a certain... There was this one thing I had. I had this like disappearing ink where basically it looks like you just squirted ink all over someone. And of course, he has like the nicest of clothes. But really, it's just water. Like it doesn't harm your clothes at all. And I do remember one time he had just... Because it takes him like an hour to get ready like every day. So he had it was like right when he walks out of the door, like he's ready to start his day. And I squirt. This was like 5 years ago. I squirt like all the ink all over him. And he just like looks down and he sees like blue stuff all over him. He's like, Patrick! But like that was on camera. Like I got that on camera. So
what's that?
What's what?
What did you get for me? I'm going to be late.
No.
Let me see that.
No.
I'm going to destroy that camera right now. No. I'm going to actually destroy it.
Do not. Look what you did.
Now I have to change my shirt.
No.
I'm going to destroy that right now.
No.
Thomas, do you know I can get the long shot?
I couldn't.
Oh, hey! Thomas, okay, what do you want? What do you want from me?
I will whip you. Heavily.
Do you have Thomas. Any idea, like, what percentage of your followers follow primarily because of Quincy and primarily because of Thomas?
No, I can't see, like, I can see, like, my demographics, like, women, men, like, mm-hmm. the countries they're located in, but I can't see, like, based off the content I post. I would, if I had to guess, it's probably, like, 85% Quincy, 15% mm-hmm. Thomas. But, again, out of, like, the 4 to 5 million followers I have, almost all of those, like, YouTube is one of my smaller platforms. Like, Facebook's my largest, and Thomas isn't on there. And so... It's just my YouTube subscribers are really the only ones that see Thomas the most.
We are brought to you by Fairbury Furniture. Fairbury Furniture is a delightful furniture store in downtown Fairbury that sells all of the most stylish and comfortable furniture from all of your favorite brands at excellent prices. They're staffed with great people and everyone in this area loves them. So when you decide it's time to get some quality furniture, head nowhere else but the one and only Fairbury Furniture in downtown Fairbury, Illinois.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
That's saying, so you said that YouTube's one of your smaller yeah. social media platforms, but... You have over 10 videos that have over 1 million views.
Yeah. There's videos that randomly like go viral. I don't know. Like I'll post a video and like in a week it has maybe like 15, 20,000 views. And then like a year later it'll have like 2 million. And I'm like, whoa, I don't know. But the algorithms of these social medias are all weird. So mm-hmm. I'm like, thank you. But
so I want to go back to when you were in college for a second mm-hmm. and ask, as you were gaining popularity, more followers, more views per video on Vine, because mm-hmm. that's where it all started.
Right.
Were you at any point surprised? I'm sure you were surprised, right? How did you feel just, you know, gaining this kind of fame on the internet?
I guess it was kind of cool at the time, like being in college, like you're surrounded by all your friends like all the time. And so they're seeing it happen while you're doing it. And like a lot of them I would like involve. Like I had people that I would have to film my videos and stuff. And so, you know, they were involved with it as not as much as I was, but it was really fun just like experiencing that with everyone going through college. And yeah. What was the folk like? Maybe no, I'll answer it. Just,
what was that like to, you know, gain that popularity? Were you ever like, overwhelmed? What is happening?
I was so like in college, honestly, it was probably like my busiest time of my life because, you know, I was going to school. I also was an RA. So like it was like my job. And then I was making these videos. So like I'd wake up, school, do like my RA job whenever I had to do that. And then I was filming videos. And I was like, every day for like my junior and senior year, I was like, that's all I would do pretty much. Cause that's when it started my junior year.
How much time did you put into making these videos? Was it just like a hobby or when did you start taking it seriously?
So I did it probably as a hobby almost all of college cause I wasn't really making money off of it. So I can't really, it was a hobby for those first 2 years. I think I actually made money for the first time my senior year. I got like a deal with Jolly Rancher, but besides like that one thing, it was all just doing it for fun. Like there was videos that I would spend like 2 hours filming because there was a time like on Vine, like you didn't have editing software, like you couldn't film something and then edit it and then post right. it. Vine was a thing where you had to film it on the app. So like if you were filming a full skit that had like 7 scenes and you messed up on the 6th scene, you would have to redo the yeah. entire video.
Wow.
So like there was times when I would spend like hours or like a whole day just trying to shoot one video. And so I had fun doing it. I wouldn't have done it if I didn't have fun. So yeah, it was definitely some crazy times back then. I couldn't really imagine doing that now, but it was a lot of fun back then.
So I was gonna ask, when was the first time that you actually made money doing this? And when was the first time that you considered, you know, maybe making this a career somehow? Yeah. You said that some about Jolly Ranchers. Can you tell me more about that?
Yeah, they just reached out. So my senior year is when I was reached out to by like a management, like a talent agency. Mm-hmm. And they basically just managed brand deals for a bunch of social media influencers. And so, you know, I hopped on board with them and, you know, they brought me a deal with Jolly Rancher to just do, I think it was like 2 different videos. And it was around like Christmas time of like, I think my senior year of college. And I remember I was like, cause you know, when you're in college, like I was poor, like I had like no money.
Right.
And so, you know, I got this deal and I was like, you know, I was like, this is amazing. Like, mm-hmm. and that's like when the first time I was like, thought like, could you really make a living off of like doing this stuff?
Yeah.
And you know, and then I was fortunately able to, like after I graduated, that's what I did and I'm still able to do it.
So I want to ask more about the business side of all of this. And for the people that are curious, maybe there's people watching that are considering becoming a content creator like yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And they're probably curious to know, how did Jolly Rancher actually approach you? Right. And what exactly was their offer, if you don't mind me asking?
So it wasn't, again, like they didn't approach me, if I remember correct. So like the talent agency that had me sign, I was like their client. They pitch you. So they're like giving your name to a bunch of different companies saying, you know, for this price, you can work with this person. And, you know, they just take their cut. So they probably pitched me to Jolly Rancher and said, you know, they'll do like a couple, 1 or 2 videos. And this is how much you'll have to pay him to do a video on Vine. And so that's how I got that deal with them.
Okay.
And that's how most, I would say, influencers get their brand deals, is from whatever manager or agency that they're signed with.
Did they like DM you or something, this agency?
Yeah, they emailed me, I think.
Okay.
And I think, and I also knew like someone else that was on Vine that I already signed with them, and they're like, oh, they're a legit company, like, you know, they had worked with companies before. And I was like, okay, well, I'd like to make some money.
Yeah.
So I hopped on board with them.
Okay. And so what was their deal? They said, if you make 2 videos with Quincy or something, yeah, and you somehow incorporate Jolly Ranchers yep. into that? Were they specific on how you would have to incorporate Jolly Ranchers? Or
They were – Jolly Rancher, I remember, was they were pretty – gave me most of the creative freedom. But obviously, like, I think it like goes around Christmas. So it was like a pack of Jolly Rancher candy canes was one. And then they had like a Jolly Rancher drink, I want to say, for the other one, which was weird. But I think – I think one of them may have been a photo. I did a photo with Quincy. Then the other one, I just like I said, like he'll like snap at you. So I like acted like he had like Jolly Rancher candy canes in his stocking, and I acted like I was going to take it from him, or, and he was not having it. And I think that was the video I did. But yeah, they gave me most of the creative freedom to do that.
Okay. And how about the money side of things? What did they give you for two videos? Two six-second videos, right? Yeah,
six
right?
seconds. Yep. And again, this is – I was in college and I had no money. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I got this offer and it was $5,000 to do
– 5,000 bucks.
Yeah.
For two six-second videos.
Yeah. And so that was like my first like wow moment. Like when I remember I was just on cloud nine. I was just sitting there. I was like, 5,000. I was like, this is insane. And, you know, I, of course, I had student loans I had to pay off and all that. But, like, at the time, it was just, like, the greatest thing I remember. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was crazy.
Dang. Okay. Yeah. So, did you do the wise thing with that and, like, put it away in the bank? Or did you take all your friends out no. to eat and drink or something?
No, I definitely, like, I probably had a lot. I went straight to college, I'd imagine. Well, yeah, no, it was during my senior year. So, like, I put it straight to my student loans because I did not want those to accrue like any interest. Mm-hmm. And so I try to pay those off as quickly as possible.
Once and Again is a remarkable resale shop that sells and consigns pre-owned name brand clothing and shoes for your entire family. This year, they celebrate 20 years of business serving our local community and beyond. Once and Again also has a great selection of pre-owned, authentic designer handbags without the designer price tag. Once and Again has an ever-changing inventory of name brands in their spacious locations in both Fairbury and Pontiac, Illinois. Along with their tag color clearance systems, shopper rewards, and other promotions, they have prices that will fit any budget. Once and Again is open Tuesday through Saturday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. You can even shop online with them too at onceagain.com. That's the letter N, not the word and. For more information about consignment or brands or for directions to their stores, simply visit onceandagain.com. That's Once and Again, located in Fairbury and Pontiac, Illinois.
What were you going to school for? What were you studying during all this?
So I majored in marketing and like IT. I double majored in
both. Okay, so kind of the field that you were that you were working in already.
Yeah, it was funny because I started out as like computer science, IT, and I absolutely hated it. Like the coding and all that. I absolutely hated that. And so like my sophomore year is when I made the switch to do like marketing, and I enjoyed that much more, but I was so far into the other one that it was just, I needed a few more classes to complete it.
Wow.
Yeah. So I ended up just getting both.
So you were pretty much well equipped to handle the business side of your social media content creation stuff, right? Because you had a marketing degree. So if people wanted to have you sponsor, or I don't know how to say it. Here's a simple question. How do you make money now? Because this is your career. Right. Obviously, you're not doing it for free. Yeah. I don't need to know numbers or anything, but how do you make money now?
Yeah, so when I graduated, like again, I said that was – I was shocked that I made that off of like the one, six – or the two videos. And so I graduate, and then I thought – I was like, well, I have these two majors. Like, it's funny because I graduated with these two college majors and then I've yet to utilize them. You know, 6 years after I graduated, I haven't applied either of those majors once with a corporate job. But, you know, I graduated, but I actually did work part time at State Farm for a little while. So I wasn't able to make like enough of a living at the time where I could just solely live off of social media, and I needed like, you know, I wanted like benefits like 401k and all that. So I did get a part-time job with State Farm just working in the sales department. So between that and my social media, you know, I was able to make like a living. Mm-hmm. And then you know, before I got married a couple years ago is when I was really able to completely quit State Farm and completely do social media full time.
Wow.
Yeah.
That had to be a crazy moment for you. It's like, all right,
yeah,
this is the main gig now. This is the only gig.
Right.
Like I'm
right,
focusing all my time and attention
yeah.
to making these videos, to working with businesses, doing yep. some like marketing stuff.
Right.
So was there any pushback to your decision to make this your full-time job?
Oh yeah, there was plenty. My parents are very, very like, there's like one path, like you go to college, you know, you get your degrees and then you go get a job. Like, especially my mom, I'd say my dad was a little more like, you know, as long as you're able to make a living off of it, like you do your own business, like that's amazing. My mom has always been like, even now, like she'll be like, there was a job posted on this company. I'm like,
oh, that's, dude, that's
I was like, that's great. I wonder who's going to get that job. I'm like, it's not me.
Gosh.
But yeah, there was definitely, you know, so I'm fortunate. And my wife, which is your sister, was yeah. like supportive. And like right before we got married is again, when I quit. So that was like, obviously a huge leap to take for both me, but also her to have faith in me. So, mm-hmm. you know, I was very thankful and appreciative of that.
And given the content that you create, you're not a political commentator. Mm-mm. You're making videos with your dog and with Thomas. And, you know, you also do various lifestyle vlogs and stuff when you yeah. guys go hiking, things like that.
Yeah.
Do you ever have like hate mail or any, like, did people ever get angry at you? I don't know that they could, but do
it
they?
Usually happens when a video, it always happens when there's more eyes on it always happens when there's more eyes on a video, right? So like if a video is not really being seen, like there's not many people commenting on it in general, mm-hmm. but like when a video is really blow up, there's so many people seeing it. So you're always going to have differing opinions and so it's funny, like people will be arguing in the comments, some people will like, someone will post hate comment about me, and then I'll have some of my followers like defend me in the comments. That's so funny. Like I don't even read comments, to be honest, anymore. I'll maybe read the first like 10 to 20, and that already gives me like an idea of what all of the comments are going to be. Like you only really have to read a little bit to see like the gist of what the majority of the comments are going to be.
What are the mean comments? Like, what do they say?
You know, so again, a lot of my videos are my dog. So like, if Quincy, like, they'll be like, oh, he's too aggressive. You shouldn't be training her. And so it's just like, that dog, you know, that dog should be put down. Like, some people say some mean things. And I just, you know, at first, when you first start getting into social media, that's like, it is a pretty hard barrier to like get through, because you do read a lot of comments when you first start out, because you're really into it. Like you're trying to see what people are saying about your videos, but you read the hate comments. For every 10 amazing comments that you read about yourself, the one hurt comment will, you'll forget about all the 10 great comments, and you'll only focus on that person that just like, you know, said something mean about you or your dog or whatever it may be. And so what I learned to do is just stop reading the comments. I just would post a video. Like I learned to just, if I enjoyed the content and I thought it was funny, I thought most people would like it, I'm not going to care about like what other people think. And I'm just going to upload it and let it do what it's going to do and stop reading the comments. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I would suggest to most people that are like doing social media, that are maybe like, I don't know, trying to start a channel on something, but they're nervous of what people think. I would just like, just do whatever makes you feel comfortable, whatever your passion is, whatever you enjoy doing, and forget about what anyone else has to say.
Yeah. On YouTube now, you can actually disable comments.
Yeah.
I guess if someone's doing something brand new and you don't want to risk having someone just rip your heart out with a mean comment,
mm-hmm.
you know, do what you got to do.
Yeah.
At the same time, oh, I always get bummed out when there's like a video and they disable comments. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
You know, why?
See that stuff when it's like, I don't know, someone just went through like a big controversy, like a celebrity, and then they just turn it off just because they know that 90% of the comments could be like mean. So they just disable it. But yeah, no, I've never disabled comments. Also, it also hurts you in the algorithm. So again,
right.
When people comment on your videos, the more people that comment, Facebook, Instagram, all these companies are pushing that video out to more people, the more people comment and engage with your content.
If you have trees or tree stumps on your property that you want gone, go nowhere else but Livingston County's premier tree service provider, Forest Edge Tree Service. Your yard is no place for looming, dead, or damaged trees, because it's just a matter of time before they come down, ruining your property, ruining your week, and ruining your bank account. This is exactly why you need to be a responsible adult and hire the services of Forest Edge Tree Service. Simply give Joe Rudin a call or even a text at 815-615-3037 to get a free quote today. Forest Edge Tree Service is fully staffed with trained professionals who use cutting-edge equipment to get the job done right every time. Their cleanup is top-notch, they're fully insured, and their customers are always pleased with the job that they do. So keep your family, pets, vehicles, and neighbors safe and save yourself from a world of headaches when you call or text Forest Edge Tree Service to get those dangerous, looming, troublesome trees off of your property. Once again, that's Forest Edge Tree Service at 815-615-3037, Livingston County's premier tree service provider.
Do you think, you know, you mentioned the algorithm. Mm-hmm. Is there any, like, secret formula to creating content that will go viral? Is there any secret, or is it purely luck?
It's a little bit of both. So, you know, it's usually really random when something does go viral, but there are, like, little things. I would say videos that are shorter, like maybe less than 30 seconds, are tend to go viral more. It's like shorter clips, things that aren't staged, like skits, like back in Vine and stuff, you use like relatable skits that were like scripted, used to do well, but like nowadays it's more like just things that happen that are caught on camera.
Like outrageous occurrences. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like things that are just people were filming and they catch on camera. Or if you're able to make a video look like it was just caught on camera, but really you staged it.
Yeah.
And that's what a lot of people do. But yeah, there's not like a secret to like going viral. It's just, I would say building up your brand is more important for going viral. Like once you have like a following and people love your content, a video will go viral just based off of your own followers watching it and getting you millions of views.
What advice maybe can you give to aspiring content creators that want to be doing what you're doing in a different way, you know, not with the dog, not with their brother?
Right.
What advice can you give just to an aspiring YouTuber or not Vine person, TikToker?
TikToker,
yeah. You know, these are different worlds, kind of YouTube, TikTok.
Yeah.
But
my biggest advice for them.
People that want to make videos,
right,
that get seen, you know.
I'm trying to think of like my best advice. I would say, because like with what I did is I just made content that I enjoyed, that I just, it was like a hobby. I would say people that are doing it just because they want to make a career out of it, or they just want to make money off of it, and that's all they care about, they probably won't go anywhere and they won't enjoy it either. But right. The people that just do it, like when I first started YouTube, like that year I graduated, when I was trying to do it full time, I didn't make a dime on YouTube for a whole year. And I was posting 3 videos a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, for a whole year. I was posting a video and I didn't make any money on it. And then once you get a certain amount of views, YouTube monetizes your channel, and then, you know, you're able to make money on it. But like, I can't imagine someone doing something for a year, doing something they don't enjoy. So I would, and I'd say the other thing is people, a lot of people like care, I think, what other people think. Like, they're just like, oh, what are my friends or what are people going to think, right, if I just start like putting myself out there, doing something like out of their comfort zone? Mm-hmm. They should just get past that, because that's like the only way you're really going to like improve and get somewhere, is completely forgetting about what other people think and just doing what you know. I'm trying to think of,
just
I'm like
to be
rambling.
Truly authentic.
Yeah, you have to be truly authentic in what you're doing. Otherwise, you probably aren't going to go anywhere.
Yeah, otherwise it's an act, and that's going to get old.
Everyone's going to figure that out. And again, you're not going to enjoy doing it either. You're going to get very tired of it, and you'll just move on to something else. So you actually have to enjoy making videos, I would say, to do that full time.
I've heard some really successful like business entrepreneurs, people in business, say that, would you do your career for free?
Right.
If the answer is yes, I would do that for free, then, you know, then that's probably a good career that you're in.
Exactly.
I even think about this podcast. Like at the beginning of it, you know, I wasn't doing anything. It was just like a for fun podcast.
Right.
And, you know, now I get some money from sponsors and stuff. Thank you very much to those sponsors. But, you know, would I do it for free? Of course, because I was doing it for free.
Exactly.
Just like you were making those videos for free.
Yeah, right? You just have to, everyone has a passion. Every single person has something they enjoy doing. And if they're able to convey that through videos, and then I think everyone would have like a story or something to share with people that people would be interested in, or whether it's something that's comedy related, whether it's like, you know, flipping houses, like whatever thing people are have a passion for, people will relate to that and enjoy watching your videos, but you have to enjoy doing it as well.
Great point. I mean, you put it very well there.
Yeah. If you don't like making videos, even if you enjoy, you know, painting, but you're like, I wish I could make videos on that, you know, you're not going to go anywhere if you don't enjoy it.
Right. So we're getting towards the end of this thing, Patrick.
Yeah.
I just want to ask one question before I ask a couple more questions. Just curious, what kind of connections have you made with these videos, you know, with Quincy, because of Quincy, because of your videos doing so well on Facebook and YouTube, Vine, TikTok, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Have you found yourself in like some situations meeting people that you're just like, I can't believe I'm meeting this person because of these videos?
Well, so like there's been a few celebrities that we, you know, have been able to meet through just like social media that I've, you know, like Steve-O was one that we filmed with in LA. Howie Mandel was one.
Wow. These are big name people.
Yeah. So, and it's not like I just was with them while we filmed some videos. Those are like two of the bigger ones. And then again, whatever like TV show that our clips have been on, I guess like whatever celebrity host was like interviewing us.
Mm-hmm. But you were on Dr. Oz, weren't you?
I forget if it was Dr. Oz. It was called The Doctors. And it was like that main host guy that it was funny. That was probably one of the weirdest shows that I remember getting contacted for.
It was like, why?
I have an animal on there. And they're like, I'm like, wow, this is an odd show to approach me to do an interview. Like usually talking about health issues, but they had a vet on that day, I think. And so they were talking, because I think they said something about his like, how is he actually aggressive and something like that? And so like the vet was trying to like analyze it and stuff, saying like, well, it could just be their breed that acts like that, but they're actually not aggressive. And yeah, so that. Those were some of the shows. MTV Ridiculousness. That was
That would fit perfectly.
Yeah, there was a couple of clips that were on there, but those were some of the main ones I can think of.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And what does last question about the business stuff? What does a typical day? What's a workload look like for you?
Like now?
Yes, now.
So things have transitioned a lot since. Like I have able to like expand to where now I'm like licensing other people's clips. So like if I see like animal clips that I think would go viral, like on Facebook, that's like, I would say my main source of income right now is Facebook. And so I license these clips from people. And then I also throw some of my own clips in there with Quincy. And I do like these best animal clips of the week, best animal clips of the month. And that takes a long time because I have to like message each person. I have to get their permission. I have to find the videos. And so a lot of my time is actually taken up by that right now. And then, you know, when I have, like today, I filmed a video for my YouTube channel with Quincy and Thomas. So we were out doing that. But it's just kind of a mix between filming, editing, licensing clips, reaching out to people, you know. I would say it's kind of a combination of all that.
We are brought to you by the Coffee Steamer. The Coffee Steamer is Livingston County's premier coffee joint. Their trailer in Fairbury boasts delicious and decadent coffee drinks, teas, and smoothies, while their full-service cafe in Forrest has all that, plus tons of incredible baked goods, sandwiches, and salads. Life is too short to drink bad coffee, so head on over to the Coffee Steamer and start your mornings off right. That's the Coffee Steamer in Fairbury and Forrest, Illinois.
And how many views do these video compilations that you make, like best animal clips of the week, how many views do those get on Facebook?
Last year was a really good year. Like each video was getting like probably averaging like 5 million or more views every single video.
Holy cow.
And this year there's, you know, it usually the last 3 months of the year are the best for advertisers. So that's when your videos are getting pumped out to more people. And so usually the last 3 months of the year are the best. But yeah, Facebook has gone really well lately.
As everyone knows, the primary star of the content that you create is Quincy, your dog. However, as you and I both know, dogs don't live forever. So what's the plan after, you know, Quincy goes away?
Yeah, that's a question a lot of people have asked me. And I guess my best answer is, so like with what I'm doing right now with the licensing clips and things like that, like I could still do that. I wouldn't be able to put Quincy's own clips in there right now, but usually that's only like one or two clips. I'd still be able to post those. And then I also want to transition, you know, I plan of course getting another dog eventually. So people that have followed me and followed Quincy, I think it would be easier for them to latch on to another dog. Again, it won't be Quincy, but I think I would still be able to make some good content with another young puppy, playful dog. And then transition that to like a more family-oriented, like for YouTube at least, like a YouTube channel, family. You know, we want to have kids and just kind of incorporating into a whole family-type vlog.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. So you've obviously thought that through.
I have thought that through. And of course, you know, it's not like we have kids or anything yet, but that moving forward, that's like where I see, you know, things going for some of my social media.
And last thing here then, what's been the best part of this whole adventure? I mean, this, you probably didn't grow up as a little kid thinking that this is what you were going to be doing.
Right.
But what you're doing is wildly successful. What's been the best part of all of this?
I'm trying to think. That's a tough question. The best part about it, honestly, I just enjoy like making the videos. Like I love the coming up with an idea and like immediately think like I know this is gonna do well, like on social media. Like I know this concept, this relatable skit, this video is gonna do well, and then like posting it and seeing that happen. I think that's really cool, and I've always enjoyed doing that since the beginning, just coming up with the ideas. My favorite part is for sure coming up with the idea. That's 100% been when I come up with that idea and I'm able to post it, it's great.
Man, it sounds like you are a content creator to the core.
I couldn't imagine. Well, I could imagine because I was working at State Farm and I did not enjoy it there. So I couldn't imagine like doing something else. And I've really enjoyed being able to do this. And I'm very fortunate that I'm able to.
Right on. Heck of a story.
Thank you.
Awesome what you were doing. Patrick Barnes, thank you so much for coming on. It was a pleasure to have you.
Thank you. Thank you again.
My pleasure.
Yep.
All right. That's a wrap, man.
Awesome.
And that's a wrap. Thank you so much for listening to that episode of The Paul Garcia Show. If you've enjoyed this episode, please share it on Facebook or with your friends. And if you haven't already, like this page on Facebook and subscribe on YouTube. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, please leave this show a 5-star rating and an honest review. If you'd like to support The Paul Garcia Show, you can do so by donating any dollar amount on Venmo to The Paul Garcia Show. Additionally, if you'd like to become a monthly donor and gain access to exclusive bonus footage, you can do so on patreon.com/Paul Garcia. Until next Sunday, thanks for listening and watching. I'm Paul Garcia. God bless and have a great week.